In this FAA Part 107 exam tutorial, I cover material on various types of aircraft speeds, such as calibrated airspeed, true airspeed, and ground speed. I also talk about navigation methods that determine the speed and altitude, such as dead reckoning and wind triangle. A lot of the material covered in this tutorial is similar to that in the study guide I used to prepare for and successfully pass the FAA Part 107 exam with a 90% score. Also, there are many other YouTube tutorials I made to help you prepare for the exam. I linked all of these resources in the description and above. According to FAA regulation, remote pilots in control of drones must not exceed ground speed of 100 miles per hour or 87 knots. Also, pilots must not fly higher than 400 feet above ground level. The exception is flying near structures within a 400 feet radius. In this case, you are allowed to fly 400 feet above the structure's top. The next important concept to cover is airspeed. First, there is the indicated airspeed, which is the airspeed at which the aircraft moves through the air on your flight path according to onboard equipment. However, equipment on airlines, such as wing flaps, may cause instrument error. When you adjust indicated airspeed for this instrument and other position errors, you get calibrated airspeed. Then there is the notion of true airspeed. Because airspeed changes with altitude, temperature, and humidity, your actual or true airspeed will be different from your calibrated airspeed. For instance, the air is less dense at high altitudes since there are fewer air molecules in the air. This creates less drag on the flying aircraft. This means that the aircraft will be flying at a true airspeed that is higher than the calibrated airspeed. True airspeed will be equal to calibrated airspeed under the following conditions. First, the airplane must fly at the mean sea level. Second, there must be a standard day condition. This means 15 degrees Celsius, 0% relative humidity, and barometric pressure of 29.92 inches mercury. Under any other conditions, calibrated airspeed will be different from true airspeed. The next concept is ground speed, which is the horizontal speed relative to Earth's surface. This is the most important speed definition, since you can use it to calculate the time to fly from point A to point B on the surface. Ground speed is different from true airspeed, since ground speed is measured relative to points on Earth's surface. Ground speed can be different from true airspeed due to an aircraft's flight angle relative to horizon and wind speed direction. Let me illustrate what this means. Let's examine the effect of wind speed direction first. Consider an airplane that flies on a straight line path parallel to the horizon. The airplane has a certain heading, which is defined as the direction the aircraft fuselage is pointing to along its longitudinal axis. Heading is measured in degrees relative to north. To learn more about longitudinal axis, check out my flight control tutorial for the FAA Part 107 exam I linked above. But what if there is a wind blowing from the aircraft's left side? This will create drift and make the aircraft deviate from its heading. The actual path the aircraft will fly is called track, as shown on the diagram. As you can see, the wind will not only make the aircraft deviate from its heading, but also affect its ground speed by creating a drag in the air. Let's consider another scenario when there is a perfect tailwind. The aircraft continues flying in a straight line parallel relative to horizon. In this case, the ground speed will be higher than the true airspeed by exactly the speed of the wind. Conversely, perfect headwind makes ground speed lower than the true airspeed by the value of wind speed. Another factor I mentioned that will make ground speed and true airspeed differ is the aircraft's flight angle relative to Earth's horizon. Consider the side view of an airplane flying on a still day. Still day means no wind. Here, the airplane flies on an upward trajectory, as indicated by the black arrow. The ground speed will be lower than the true airspeed. This is so because the airplane will have to cover a longer distance in the air to get from point A to B in a non-straight path. This will take more time as opposed to flying on a path parallel to Earth's horizon. Ground speed is calculated as the distance divided by the time to fly. Since time to fly in the denominator is bigger in a non-straight path, the ground speed will be lower than the true airspeed. We can conclude that the only scenario when ground speed will be equal to true airspeed is under the following two conditions. First, the aircraft must fly at a straight flight path at 0 degrees angle relative to horizon. Second, there must be a still day with no wind. There is a variety of equipment and methods that can help a remote pilot keep the drone's ground speed under 87 knots. Among them are GPS devices or other sensors installed on a drone that measure the ground speed. Another notion that pilots use in navigation is pilotage. Pilotage refers to navigating the aircraft by reference to specific landmarks. This could be flying along interstate roads or flying from one known lake to another. Flying by pilotage becomes a problem when there is low visibility due to cloud cover. Also, pilotage will not help you determine ground speed and time needed to fly from point A to point B. But you can use a method called dead reckoning to estimate your position, time to fly, and ground speed of your aircraft. In simple terms, dead reckoning refers to measuring ground speed by flying from specific point A to point B. You do so by knowing the distance between these points from maps and time you measure during your flight. This will allow you to calculate your ground speed. If you continue flying with the same speed, it will let you estimate a new time to fly from, say, point B to point C. This is the explanation of dead reckoning in simple terms. However, you have other variables that will influence your dead reckoning estimates. A few of them are wind and flight angle relative to horizon that we just covered. The dead reckoning method is prone to mistakes due to so many variables that will affect speed and time estimates. For this reason, pilots use it less often these days and rely on GPS devices instead. The concept closely related to dead reckoning is the wind triangle. The wind triangle allows you to estimate track and ground speed by using true airspeed and heading along with wind speed and direction. The wind triangle is represented by drawing velocity vectors, as is shown on this diagram. The length of velocity vectors represent the speed of an aircraft or wind. The vector direction shows the direction of wind or aircraft. To get ground speed and track of an aircraft, you need to know your true airspeed and heading as represented by this vector. You also need to know wind speed and direction. Thus, the velocity vector that connects your current position with the end of wind vector allows you to estimate aircraft track and ground speed using vector math. While you do not need to know formulas for your Part 107 exam, you should be familiar with these concepts. The next topic I will cover is how to comply with the altitude limit of 400 feet above ground level, or 400 feet above structure stop and around the structure. One way is to install a calibrated device or GPS capable of reporting altitude. You can also pace 400 feet from your launch spot to get a sense what a 400-foot distance looks like. It's also possible to use mountains, hills, or artificial structures with known heights above ground level as reference points. Sectional charts can help you identify the heights of these objects. Let's check your understanding of flight speeds and how to determine flight altitude. The first question wants to know when true airspeed is equal to calibrated airspeed. We can see that the choices A and B are incorrect, because these are conditions for the true airspeed and ground speed to be the same. From before, the calibrated airspeed will differ from the true airspeed as long as there are deviations from standard day conditions and the mean sea level. This makes C the answer. The next question asks you to identify the condition under which ground speed and true airspeed are the same. As we just covered in the previous question, ambient temperature and altitude are some of the conditions for true airspeed and calibrated airspeed to be the same. For ground speed and true airspeed to be equal, the aircraft must fly on a still day with no wind and 0 degrees angle to horizon. This makes choice C the answer. The next question tests your knowledge of pilotage. We know from before that pilotage is helpful to navigate from point to point by referencing known landmarks. It's not helpful to determine ground speed or time to fly. This makes choice C the answer. The next question wants you to identify measurements needed to determine ground speed with the wind triangle method. The wind triangle method uses true airspeed, aircraft heading, wind direction, and wind speed to determine the aircraft track and ground speed. Both indicated and calibrated airspeed measurements are inadequate for this task. You must know the aircraft true airspeed. This makes choice C the answer. The fifth question tests your knowledge of methodology to determine ground speed of a drone. We know from before that pilotage is not helpful to determine ground speed. This makes choice B incorrect. Choice C is incorrect too. While it's true that you can calculate ground speed using wind triangle, you must know the drone's true airspeed. But it's impossible to know true airspeed without special equipment installed on the drone. At the same time, you can use a simplified dead reckoning method to determine ground speed by timing your drone's flight between two known fixed points and taking into account wind speed and direction. Doing so will allow you to note the power setting for your drone that will produce a ground speed of 87 knots or less. This makes choice A the answer. The next question wants to know which resource you can use to determine the altitude of the terrain or structures near the launch site. A sectional chart is the only resource that references heights of structures and terrain from the choices below. This makes choice A the answer. The seventh final question is this. It wants to know how you can identify the required 400 feet altitude. Choice B is incorrect. Per FAA regulations, remote pilots can operate only one drone at a time. Choice C is incorrect too. While towers can indeed provide height references, they have guy wires around them. The FAA recommends flying at least 2,000 feet away from guy wires for strike avoidance purposes. This will likely prevent you from getting the visual reference of what 400 feet looks like near towers. At the same time, you can gain a visual reference of 400 feet by pacing near your launch site. This makes choice A the answer to this question. This is it for today's tutorial. In my next FAA Part 107 exam tutorial, I will cover how to compute the weight and balance of an aircraft. In the meantime, feel free to ask any questions if you need clarifications for the material covered in this video in the comments below. If you found this video helpful, please give it a like and subscribe to our channel. We will have more tutorials that will help you prepare for the FAA Part 107 exam. We also regularly post travel guides and photography tutorials. Thanks for watching.